Good evening, spirits and specters, and welcome to another terrifying chapter of Blood from a Stone, a tale of love and dread in RPG. Hi, my name is Philip, and I am your dread master, and penning me in from three sides are some of our wonderful players. Say good evening, players.
Good evening, players.
I don't, Dan really got into my head with this whole ensconced thing, but now when there's like only three, I don't know how to describe.
You can say surrounding me.
And then on Tuesday, I had Liv and Lauren over me, and I was like, because I always put women above me, or I said some real nonsensey thing like that. And that
did real
not,
cool.
I did not get a good reply. I did not get a good reaction from folks, let me tell you. Welcome, everyone. It's really good to have you guys here. This is going to be a fun one. We're in September, which means we don't have all of our players all the time, but we're always happy with who we have. And you know, I have to say that horror sometimes can really blossom in a smaller, intimate group with fewer resources and fewer people who can help. So to that point, we have what we've been doing in this game. Makes it very hard to sort of recap and explain, but I think in some ways it actually makes it very easy to jump into because it's all very just kind of like all over the place storytelling, so just hop on in. It's kind of, we have a lot of open threads now, and this phase of the game here at, we are chapter 112 tonight. 112 chapters, that's a lot of chapters. It's a nice shirt, it's a very good one.
Great job, Zane.
For the chat.
No, they're happy about it. We have a lot of open threads. How many open threads? To count the number of open threads that we have, I think there are 12 open threads right now.
Almost as many as 13.
Almost as many as 13. And basically, if we roll a 13, that means we start a new thread, which we did about 3 weeks ago, but I think a lot of us are really in agreement. That's like one of the most fun things of late is this new story on a boat. And we very likely will return to that. I will also mention that not each one of these is weighted at the same level. You know, there are certain threads that are a little more sort of prominent, and I do base it sometimes on which players we have available. For example, tonight, with the three of you here, I know Dan is not here, but he's out all month, this makes camera, producer, and PA a little more likely to appear, since that's like just you guys. So, we have a lot of different threads open. We also have a beautiful, saintly little dread clock here. It's at the hour of 5. Now, I want to talk to everyone about something that that my dear friend KJ brought up on Wednesday. Because KJ, when dealing with Maisie in a Top Flight Universe game, rolled a 13 on a percentile die. It's only 1% chance. It's so crazy. And not only that, she rolled a d13. And her extreme success rate was 13.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like we should advance this, but then Lauren got very mad at me. She called me a really mean word off stream. I almost don't even want to say what she said.
Did I?
You did. You said the worst thing you can call a person. You said I was you said I was being inconsistent.
Oh, that's
the meanest thing you can say. So right now the dread clock is at 5. I am going to, I think what I'll do now is I'll do recaps, not for the big picture recap is that, school at Darkmoor College has changed inexorably now that Dracula has been summoned as a character. Guys get it, like summoned. He was summoned like a normal character from a book. Because he wasn't. The secret is he wasn't. So upon doing so, Dracula set out an open call for all vampires to come to him at Darkmoor. We have learned that there are sort of like power struggles among other vampires and who should be in charge and who owes obeisance to whom and what and which and why. But then throughout these mists, which are also broken thanks to the work of one Alvin Theodore, Have I told you, by the way, that I want to say Alvin Tostig, which is the character from Leave On, a Elton John song, every time I want to say Alvin Tostig, not Alvin Theodore. That's just a little fill-up fact for you guys. The mists are broken. The Dreadlands are no longer sort of separated the way they used to be, though they still have some geographic, you know, sort of power, and the dread storms that rush across are now something that the Mistwalkers seem immune to, whereas the others suffer tremendous fears and enervation whenever they are hit with that sickly sweet, coppery aftertaste, sort of miasma that they occasionally will pass through. With all that in mind, rather than recap all 12 of those, or even just the primary ones, we will recap as we arrive at each scenario. So before we begin that, as we kind of were just bouncing all over the place and my poor players have to jump between, you know, there are up to 13 different game systems. We have never used four of them, not even one time. We have now gone to Ignador, but in Ignador, I'm basically letting the people there already have characters from other systems. So I'll rephrase it as this. We have no player character who is native to Ignador yet. So therefore they're not using that system. I'm kind of letting people just use whichever system the place they're from is and just try to sort of sort it out. It's absolute chaos, and I appreciate you guys just kind of rolling with it because, you know, in our most RP heavy game, it's pretty funny how preposterously dice and system heavy it is. So perhaps we will make it to some of those other systems here eventually. Perhaps we will meet someone, a character who is from D'Lacker Garden, a system we don't even know what system is there. Perhaps we'll meet someone from Tabakatos. We don't know what system is operative there either. Perhaps we will meet someone from Mons Longivus.
This is a stupid question, but do you know what systems are there?
I'm going to answer this in complete honesty. I have assigned for the four spaces. Two of them are open. One of them has a system written in, and the other has a system written in with a question mark next to it. As if to say, is this what we're doing? I guess so. Now, below this...
No, wasn't a stupid question.
Below this... No, not a stupid... No, it's not a stupid question at all. Below this, do I have a massive, massive list of systems? I do. And is it possible that for one of them, we will roll randomly to see what system is used in the randomly rolled location we're going to?
Philip, you're stressing me out.
Chaos reigns. That will be a tougher thing because that will involve, oh my god, the spreadsheeting will reach a new level where we are literally live building the character sheet foundation. Lauren is so mad right now.
I don't like that.
She doesn't.
It's my least favorite thing to do aside from D20 combat, traditional combat.
She doesn't care for combat, guys. Spoiler alert. She doesn't like D20 combat. But I think, and yet I think you did appreciate the four separate system combat we had last week. Somehow that was fine. Somehow everyone having to do a different thing makes it go faster. I don't know why. So, with all of this Philip chaos in mind, you actually bring up a good point. Maybe for some of these systems, I need to go ahead and build character sheets, not during the game, just so we have them ready. I'm gonna put that on my to-do list before I do anything else. In fact, guys, because I'm deciding right now, I don't want Lauren to yell at me, and she'd be justified to do it.
Thank you.
Don't give in.
No, see, I'm fine doing the prep there because you'll still have to fill the character sheets out live if we inevitably roll that we're in this random place. So, all this in mind, my friends, I'm now going to read to you the invocation for chapter 112 of Blood from a Stone, A Tale of Love and Dread in RPG. I think, Count, you have missed your true calling. You should have been a theatrical performer. You flatter me, Miss Murray. I shall take this as a compliment and perhaps will endeavor to embrace this quality in other regards. After all, one should be the leading player of one's own life. Or perhaps, if one wishes to have some fun, the villain. So, Lauren, because you hate it so much, would you please roll a d13?
Sure. My dog might start barking in a second, though. Because he's mad at you. 8!
Your dog is mad at me?
Yeah.
Why is your dog mad at me?
I don't know, you have a foul smell or something. I'm kidding, I'm kidding.
Dog can't smell me over the computer, even I know that. 8, you say?
Yes.
I think this is a situation of giving the people what they want. As we find ourselves amidst purple mists on a mysterious island. We're going to be resuming where we were last time. So, a brief recap on that thread. A mannequin named Vela, a human woman named Emma, and a gator face from the Grave Marshes called Stiltcutter found themselves aboard a vessel having been rescued by an old salt, a strange sailor, who indicated they were all needed for some higher purpose. As they raced through a storm and managed to sort of fight off a brief attack from a large dragon that decided it didn't want to try to loop back at them, this group eventually crashed into the rocks of a mysterious mist-ringed island as the rains and storm died. It still is stormy and crazy, but it died down. There they discovered that actually a signal fire had been lit for them, but they did not, the sailor did not see it in time, by the island's, well, one of the island's only occupants, the island's only sort of human occupant, it might seem, a man named Fletch, who was sad to see that boat destroyed as he was hoping to get a ride off of here. He was a castaway. He began to lead the group of Vela, Stiltcutter, Emma, and the sailor to his camp when suddenly he realized horror was beginning to surge. Something was coming for them. And then the group were attacked by horrible creatures that Fletch referred to as screamers. They are sort of elongated people with exaggerated features, kind of big mouths and huge eyes. Their arms are so long they trail in the dirt as they walk with these very extended, like, you know, 8 to 9 inch long fingers. They make a horrible gargling, sucking scream, one that can stun people. They wear strange light blue robes. Fletch has seen them on this island a bit. The others have never seen anything like them, not even the sailor, it would seem. The group attempted to outrun and outfight these creatures, and Fletch revealed that there was more to him than everyone realized as well. Perhaps a little earlier than we were planning, but that's what happens when you get all those horror surges, baby! As Fletch suddenly became an animated creature of dark, sort of like charcoal, you know, chiaroscuro look with a very sort of noir aesthetic with a fedora and a trench coat, but he's also blobby and inky and kind of moving, and at one point he actually like pumped his ink into one of these creatures to kill it. The group managed to fight off the creatures, and the sailor used a limited resource, which he cannot use again, actually, until some time has passed, to summon a powerful sea wind. This wind blew the creatures away into the mist where they seemed to be immobilized. But that caused the mists to part and roll across the beach, and the already stunned rest of the group, aside from Emma, who was just pretending to be stunned because she's obsessed with stillness, and also Stiltcutter likes to be still because of Predator, and Vela can be still because she's a mannequin, so there's a lot going on in this group. As this mist rolled across them, the stunned nature of their sort of like falling to those creatures gave way to a much more sort of like sucking, power draining, fear induced experience in the purple mists. And ahead of them, seen for the first time by Vela, Emma, and Stiltcutter, but not by Fletch, now lamp black, was a tall mountain. A volcanic mountain that was billowing out the very purple mist that surrounds this world, that used to separate it. It seems they have found the source of the purple mist on this island. There are other things on this far side of the island, and despite all the stuff I've sent you this week, Zane, I also need to give you a map of the island. My apologies, I'll, you know what, if people ask about the island, I can tell you what you know of this because you have experience, you know, we'll say you've explored a bit, but, because there are some things over there, but it's not stuff you kind of go to anymore. As the group look up at that mountain, that is where we're going to resume our story. I've already read the invocation. So, Stiltcutter, Vela, and Lamp Black. You are all laying on the beach in the sand, prone. Stiltcutter, you feel more tired than you can recall feeling in a very long time. Your muscles, your scales feel sort of like dry and cracked. Your muscles feel completely strained. Your jaw feels like it weighs a million pounds. And around you, Stiltcutter, I would like for you to roll. I know it is not your forte, but give me an intuition roll. Just roll a d6.
Two.
Yes. So Stiltcutter, we don't even need to go into the details of it, although if you'd like to, you can, but it will be immaterial to what you can sort of do about it. Stiltcutter, you begin to see genuine terror manifesting around you. What do you think Stiltcutter is most afraid of in the world? Is it a bigger fish from below? Is it a more existential concept, like being misunderstood? Is it something really abstract? Is it just scissors? Ooh. What do you think the fear of a gator face would be?
Crocodile heads.
Crocodile severed heads, basically.
Yeah.
Understood. All right. Well, Stiltcutter, you sort of see bobbing horribly through these mists. Heads. Heads like your own head. Crocodile. Some alligator. Some open like this. Some open like that. But the point is, they're all severed. Teeth looking unkept. Tongues lolling out.
Crocodiles. Ugly. Hideous. Not like gators.
I misunderstand. I'm sorry. So it is specific. You see, it is specifically crocodile heads that you are afraid of.
Ugh.
What are the... What's the... Caiman? Is that what they're called?
Caiman? Yeah.
Those are... Is it Caiman or Caiman? C-A-I-M.
It's Caiman.
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 Also those. You're a gator. They're similar to that. But yeah, you're worried about those. So you're worried about the ones that go like this. You go like this like a normal creature. This is absolutely. All right.
Crocodiles freak me out.
So, as you see these horrible heads of these strange top-jawed beings, you succumb to total fear, Stiltcutter, and you can't move. You're losing your like it's just taking all your life force to just sort of stay where you are. Vela.
Yep.
I need for you, my dear sweet Vela. And by the way, Vela, if you could, there's actually two Vela sheets on your sheet. I'm going to move one of them further down. That you're looking for Vela Noir. Okay.
Okay, there's something wrong with my computer right now.
Okay, that's fine. To kind of just keep us in the thing here, why don't you, really all that you have going on now is that you have, you do have a... Wait, no, I posted the thing in this. Where is all that nonsense? Oh my gosh. Shoot, is it in the other sheet? No, it's not. Okay. Well, okay, something's also wrong because I posted the incredibly complicated new do I have that on a different sheet? Sorry guys. We are spreadsheeting after all. Point is, can you make a wisdom saving throw? That's really what
is it Velenoir?
Velenoir.
Okay. Oh, it's a D20.
It is a D20 system, that's correct.
What is the oh
roll 13?
I did.
Alrighty.
Damn spirit lives on.
And we're off to a beautiful start. Alright, thank you so much for that 13. That is one.
You're not welcome.
Roll a D13, please. Come on, let's horror surge again. You guys are, if you horror surge again, you guys are basically dead.
No. No way.
Did you roll a horror surge?
Are we dead? Did you kill us all?
Can you?
Yep, that's the 13. All right.
What the fuck? I like Stiltcutter.
I don't know why this happens to me so much. Like, the odds of me doing it this much?
I mean, it was me last time, so.
No, yeah. But me specifically, I do this a lot.
Yeah, that's.
You play a lot.
That's a rough one. Much.
That's a rough one. I think. Wow.
Kind of weird knowing we're gonna die.
Well, this is one of those circumstances where, like, the not one of you is in control of yourselves right now. You are all knocked. You are all like knocked out, prone by mist, and so it's like, I mean, like, it's just like you're utterly sitting ducks. So I'm now just racking my brain for a okay. Oh no, this will be really bad. Zane. Actually, no, Lauren, let's have you do it. Lauren, roll another D13. This is your fault, you have to. If you roll another 13, that would be so interesting, but also bad.
It reverses everything.
One.
Which I don't know if it's good or bad.
Did she save her lives?
Ay, Dios. I can't handle this.
That's interesting. Okay, roll a d4 for me. Sorry, everyone. I like how the game hasn't really been started. All we know is that Stiltcutter is afraid of crocodile heads. That's all we've really gotten out of this. Three. Okay, I like this. All right. We're going to sort of play... I'm going to continue playing through what was just going on, but we'll get to it in a moment. Vella, with a 13.
Oh, God.
What is Vella afraid of?
She's afraid of being in a room full of men who have their own cigarettes. Like, their own packs of cigarettes, not the ones she's handing out, because she can kind of keep an eye on those. That's so tragic!
So basically, Vella will sort of... So basically, as Stiltcutter in the mist sees these floating heads... These like floating crocodiles, just like unnatural bending. Vella, what you see in the mist is figures. And in their hands they hold cigarettes. And the mists are coming from these cigarettes. The mists are created by the cigarettes, and what you are choking on is your own obsolescence and your own powerlessness. What you are surrounded by is the smoking haze of men who do not need you and have means of harming you that you did not give them yourselves. It is utter powerlessness, and though you're good at being still right now, you are being still not of your own accord. Vella, right now, you are no better than a dead, lifeless mannequin. You are just a thing to drape clothes on. Lamp black. What you see rising through the mist is a tentacle of ink and paint, towering, massive, a sea monster. Would you please also make a wisdom saving throw? With an 18, you manage to sort of keep much of your head about you. You manage to look past that, and though you still sort of see it, though you are afraid, you still understand what's going on. You know that it's mist, and you remember one of the last times you were in a mist like this and that you saw something similar. I'd like for you to make an insight roll.
Six.
You understand something is wrong, and yet you are still very scared. You, however, your mind has not broken, but I also need you to make a constitution saving throw. You're actually pretty good at these. Plus 5.
23.
A 23 is actually enough that Lamp Black, you alone, though you are frightened by what's happening and you see this stuff, you could sit up, or I guess in your case, just kind of like slorch up in a blob-like shape if you wanted to.
He would like to.
Okay.
And just like really kind of look around, because we just got out of a battle, and it's like, what is happening around me?
Go ahead and make a perception check. Poor, oh boy, Man Black.
10.
I have to roll this then. I have to roll this myself. Okay. Lamp Black with a 10. It's so hazy and misty that you're just fighting sort of, and as you're kind of like getting up in this sort of, you know, kind of way of looking, your perception is a little off at the moment. You can't quite hear what's going on. You can't quite see. The mist is in whatever senses you have right now in this kind of primarily ink and paint form. You're not totally sure what's going on, but I think with a 10 you are confident that the screamers are gone. You don't hear them. Occasionally you sort of bristle as you sort of see a sweeping tentacle above in the mist.
Does he see everyone else around him, or are we spread out from one another?
With the amount of time that passed, and with a 10 having been rolled, you see the sailor. The sailor is standing up like nothing, like this. He's just like standing in the midst, like,
yeah, well, it's fine then. I'll be able to.
Just muttering to himself something. And sort of he kind of walks over to you and says,
hey, you there, ink blob boy, or lamp black you called yourself.
Lamp black.
Are you immune to the mist?
Philip.
Mm-hmm.
What's the answer to that question?
Lamplack knows he's not immune to the mist. He's just bearing it right now.
I can just tolerate it for short periods. That's impressive. Can't say the same about your the rest of your friends here, or rest of my friends, that is. I suppose you've known them as long as you've known me.
The mists begin to clear. There's no sign of Stiltcutter, Vela, or Emissary.
Lamp Black wants to ask, because we all saw the mountain, correct?
Yeah.
The volcano. The,
and the mountain is slowly being, like, hidden. The sailor is staring up at it.
Is this why you're here?
I am. Wait. Ah, places, where do they go?
He starts, I'm actually going to roll this for him as well. You could make another perception check if you wanted to.
14.
All right. He actually rolled a 12, which means he spots it. So basically, you guys, you're sort of looking around, and with a 14, you're a little bit more aware. You're a little more like kind of up and sort of seeing such. The sailor, however, points at the sand a little ways away as kind of like the last vestiges of purple mist are roiling over it. And you see traces of a long gator-like snout being pulled under the sand. The sailor sort of points over there, and the lamp, like, you're seeing a rough thing of it. So lamp, like, is there anything you'd like to do?
Run toward it.
All right. Are you going to try to grab onto Stiltcutter?
Oh, I'm close enough.
I mean, yeah, it's like I will. If you're going to try to like run and like grab hold, I will let you make an athletics check.
Yes.
Cool. Go for it.
Baby.
10.
A 10. I'll say that you can get there. But by the time you're there, the gator snout has pulled completely underneath. And if you're sort of trying to dig your hands in, it's just you're just staining the beach now, as you're kind of like, yeah. The sailor, with his 12, will point you to Vela as she's going under.
Lamp Black.
There.
Try to get her as well.
Understood. Lamp Black, you can make one more athletics roll to try to hold on to Vela.
That's a 1.
Perfect. You grab hold of Vela, and sorry about this, Vela. He knows what's coming. You grab Vela's leg, and it just pops off. And so Vela is now armless and legless.
I have one arm and one leg. True. Thank you.
You are one-armed and one-legged. That is fair. And the others are they're here on the beach somewhere. But it's Lamplack, you sort of pull back with that. The sailor is kind of, he's still like barking out. He's like, "There, there!" And he points to Emma, and you see like Emma's dainty little hand going down. You have one last try, Lamplack, to try to grab hold of them.
Hey, rolled another 1.
Yeah, another 1. Lamp Black, I'm going to say that because of this, give me another wisdom saving throw.
I'm going to really roll this thing.
We can now rely on this, man.
A dirty 20.
A dirty 20. You reach for her, but it's just like two, like something, things are like, they're being, the three of them are pulled below. So horror surging in a different way here is in horror sucking. This is a horror suck, not a horror surge.
Mm.
They have been sort of pulled down somewhere. You cannot grab her either. There are now ink blots on the sand, but Vela, now missing two limbs, Stiltcutter, afraid of crocodiles, and Emma, whether she is in terror or is just, if she's just pretending, we're not sure, maybe she's just being still for the sake of it, they have been pulled under the sand. Vela?
I want to make an assumption for Emma. She's probably in terror if she knows what's going on with Vela.
True.
I'll just put that out there.
As you sort of get pulled down, the sailor is kind of like coming over to where it is, sort of looking at this, saying,
"Are there been? Do you know where they are? What did this? Is there something under the sand? Is it crabs? I hate crabs."
Does Lampblack, has he experienced anything like this before?
So this is an interesting question. And I'm going to say, I want you to make a survival roll. This will be about your knowledge of the sort of nature of what's here.
So I rolled a 13, but it is a
17.
17, yes.
All right, so roll your d13.
Okay, baby.
Come on, you can do it. You can surge.
It's a one.
A one. Okay, so no more horror surge.
Dropping some ones tonight.
Really are, guys. All right, so one more 13 there, guys. That's great. I'll even put that one in the chat. Hold on. Yeah. So we do not have a double surge, but we do have this. However, Vella and Stiltcutter and Emma are gone. Lampblack with a 17. This did happen to you once. There isn't a predator down there. There's something else. Something much stranger. Once you were on the beach, there were not mists so close. You know not to get so close to them, but you were once at the beach and it was kind of an eerie night. Looking out at the just empty ocean ahead of you, knowing how sort of small and insignificant and caught you were, you found yourself in a rather bad headspace. Rather hopeless and helpless. And you suspect that attracted something. You were sitting on the sand, kind of, not like they were prone and terrified, but you were sitting on the sand, just kind of looking out, feeling morose and hopeless. And you felt something pulling you down into the sand. But what was strange was that it was as if the sand around you was suddenly much looser and more porous than the sort of sturdy beach that you were sitting on. You felt you were being like pulled through, and then you felt you were being pulled through the island itself. Eventually, you found yourself in a strange room elsewhere on the island. The room had glass and stone. It was a design you were not familiar with. There were odd sigils on the walls. Whether or not you looked into them, we'll say you're not really sure what was going on there. What the room didn't account for, however, was the fact that you could effectively turn yourself into goo, and you were able to ooze out through a window. During your escape from this place, you did see one figure in the distance, wearing a white coat, carrying some kind of board, but it didn't seem like it was a human. You're not sure what it was, but it had a human-like quality. You emerged from this chamber, noticing there were others like it on this part of the island. You realized that you were incredibly close to the mountain. And you managed to make an escape undetected. You heard some yelling later when somebody was like about how did he get out? What happened? You know, kind of clearly your departure was noticed, but basically you were taken somewhere from the sand through the very island, through some kind of, it wasn't a creature that pulled you under. You think it was like a device, like a vacuum cleaner, just spit you somewhere into some kind of little aquarium. And you were able to escape. There are some places, there are some structures over by the mountains. And you know where that thing pulled you to. You've never willingly gone there since that time. This probably happened after you'd done your first looking over there and seen crazy stuff, and you were like, I'm out of there. But you escaped. Never went back, but you know the area in question.
The island. It takes you. They watch. There.
And he points toward the mountain.
Something's taken him, huh? It has. Well, you don't think they've been eaten? They might still be alive. Not exactly. They're taken to a room. To a room. All right. I'm sneaking there. Can you tell me where it is? Can we get there? Can you guide us there?
Lamp Black wants to, what type of, like, how'd he be feeling about this? Because I know he typically doesn't really want to go there, so.
Entirely up to you, sir. You do not have to lead this man to rescue these people. It's entirely up to you. The sailor has yet to, like, make any arguments to help you, to sort of persuade you to help him, but it's...
Why would I help you? You were supposed to rescue me. You crashed your ship. I did, indeed. But I won't be able to help you at all if they're dead. They were brought here for a reason, believe you me. I need them. What is the reason? Well, power, of course. Power enough to leave this place, certainly, but power to leave it in great style. Clearly, you must have come here looking for power yourself, didn't you? You know there's things here. You know there's incredible secrets on this island, aren't there?
There are.
Dangerous, I'm sure, but you've been alone. Now there's more of us, aren't there? Or at least there will be if we rescue them.
Can I have your word?
I'll give you me word, lad. But know that me word is as fickle as the sea winds.
It's not very helpful right now, is it?
No, it's not. But it's the best I can offer. And I could use your tricks. I've used up a fair bit of what magic me have to get rid of them screaming things. And now horror surged again in a way most unusual. This island is special, I can tell. If you want me to go off on my own, that's fine. But then don't be expecting me to help you off the island when I rescue them in return, if you understand.
I have one condition. When I make a call, you follow my lead.
I can agree to that, especially for now. I can agree to that for now.
He chooses to lead him to where he thinks they might be.
Great.
This feels like that Rorschach Batman joke.
Oh, just the two. Yar, by rars.
Two, the gruff voices.
Yeah, the
Rorschach, I'm Batman.
This is really telling you the time period of it, because this is a real, like, 2009 joke, because the joke is Rorschach from the Watchmen movie, Batman from The Dark Knight, and Clint Eastwood from Gran Torino.
Same voice.
And what you would just do is it would be like, "Hey, Batman, what do you think you're doing? I'm not Batman, I'm Rorschach. Oh, sorry, I saw a mask, and I was going to say, get off my lawn. Hey, Clint Eastwood, stop saying that to me. Sorry, Batman. No, I'm Rorschach. All right. Don't worry. You guys want to get some food later? As long as it's soup. My throat's a little sore. Weird, mine too. Me as well. I'm Batman."
That's That captured everything.
Bane is it?
Bane is a different verb of town. Well, that's really what it's all about.
I'm sorry I got him going. I'm so sorry.
Oh, don't worry. You're sorry. I'll be sorry about that. I'm back. Yeah.
Their
darkness is around.
So.
Moving on.
Well, so
we could have kept going
in a different way for Vela Stiltcutter and Emma.
Mm-hmm.
Vela and Stiltcutter.
Mm-hmm.
Oh no! Is this gonna be even grimmer? Oh, it might. I'm going to make a roll. This is interesting. I'm going to just purely do this to chance because there's benefits to doing this either way, so I don't know what would be done. Will it be evens together, odds separate? That's what we'll do. Evens together. Okay. Stiltcutter, please make a physicality roll. Vela, please make a constitution saving throw.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
I should also mention that as they go, the sailor does pick up the leg and eventually finds Vela's arm and carries those.
Okay.
Oh, thank you. 22.
Great.
Well,
it was a con save.
Con save.
Okay.
So both of you, wow. So with a 12 for Stiltcutter, very high. That's the highest you can do on your dice. Vela with a 22. Excellent. The two of you awaken. Sometime later, the mists are gone. You no longer smell those mists. In fact, you smell a very kind of, it's kind of antiseptic. It smells sort of chemically in here. Not overwhelmingly, not as an irritant. And of course, Vela, you don't really, you know, have lungs or anything. And Stiltcutter, you're more used to swimming through, you know, brackish water, so you're fine. But both of you kind of say, we'll just say it's very different. You find that you are on a stone floor. There are stone walls around. The stone is sort of smooth and polished, but seems very strong. About 4 feet up, there is shadowed glass around the room with some little slits in it, letting in a bit of light.
I have a question.
Please.
Can Vela, like, hop around?
Yeah, totally.
Okay. Yeah. I wasn't sure if she was... Okay.
No, you're going to have disadvantage on certain kinds of, like acrobatics checks or something since you're not used to it. But yeah.
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 Okay. And we're fully conscious, right?
For role-playing sake, I'll say that you're sort of... you're coming into consciousness. You're sort of you're hazy a bit. Although for Vela it's probably a little different. Actually, Vela, you probably just come straight into consciousness. Stiltcutter, it's kind of taking you a minute to wake up. But Vela, you awaken and you see that Stiltcutter is stirring. You see that Emma's chest is rising and falling, but she is unconscious still.
Okay. So I'll go. Stiltcutter. Are you okay?
Crocodiles. Ugly.
What?
Ugly.
No, there's nothing here. We're in some sort of a room. We were on the beach, right? Mm. Or did I miss something? Sometimes
sand.
I face out a little bit and I just tune out of what's going on and I was afraid that that's what might have happened when all of the mist happened and then I saw a bunch of guys with cigarettes. But I didn't give them to them, and they had way too many for me to be comfortable in. I don't know where we are.
Stiltcutter, the ever attentive listener, is just staring at her while she talks. It's like, sand, now stone, different place.
Yeah, and glass, it looks like, but... And can I, like, I'm not going to stand up yet, but can I, like, crawl toward the glass? And is it like wall to ceiling or floor to ceiling?
The glass starts about 4 feet up.
Okay, so can I like...
Or like there's like 4 feet of wall, then sort of a few feet of glass, but it's shadowy. It's kind of
Okay, well, I'm trying to think of if she, has she seen anything like this glass before?
No, this looks very different than Heistley's.
Okay. Can I do a I guess investigation to look around the room to see if there's anything
sure.
else?
Do an investigation. That's a good one. Yeah.
It's just a flat 11.
Stone walls. You don't see a door. There's a mirror that goes all the way around this room, which is about 20 feet square. There are these like slits in the glass that seem to be letting in light. You could peek through one of those if you so chose.
Okay, I'm gonna go and peek through one, but not like super close, like not with my eye right against it, but okay. Just like
it's pretty bright, so it's hard to see through. It's pretty bright compared to what's in here. Go ahead and make a perception roll.
That sure is so funny.
Well, she does that. Can I like smell or check on Emma?
21.
Absolutely. Make a knowledge roll for Emma. I think that's your D8. A 21 for Vella. Great. I'm going to resolve Stiltcutter first.
I think. Dice. I can't see these.
A six.
That's over five. So we will say that you understand how this air, this like land, this non-sea meat operates. And it is, you know, she's like asleep. She seems to be okay. She just is taking longer to wake up than the others. That's the idea. That with a 21, you're able to look out and you see there seem to maybe be some rooms that look like this, but like from the outside. So you suspect like this is like a cube that's just like outside. Like there's like some others, you know, there might be like rows of them or a circle of them or something. You're not in a hallway. No, like outside of, like if you look out, like on the ground is like dirt and grass.
Oh.
Yeah.
So nothing like the actual island that we were on.
No,
sand?
It is not sand, but it looks.
Since we went into the forest a little bit.
If you were in a forest. Okay. You saw there were forests on the island.
But it does look like the floor of the island. When
it looks like it, you could definitely be on. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not like wildly different terrain. Yeah. It's not. It's not sand though.
Okay. It looks like there's other rooms of pods like this out there. Mm. I don't know what that means. Are there other people here?
No answers in this room.
Yeah.
Move, we must.
What does the ceiling look like?
Very good question, actually. The ceiling is the same stone as the floor. It does, however, have like, it's got like a lot of like square panels, and they do seem to have like writing or symbols on them.
Do I recognize the writing or symbols?
Vella, I don't think.
Fair enough.
I don't think that's her area of expertise.
I don't mean this to be rude at all. I just don't know what your native language is. But can you read what's up there?
Can I try to read it?
You can, but I think also this is not something you would have learned in that.
No, I'll just say no.
It's not a. You can definitely make a look, but it's not. It is not a tongue of the.
Great. I'm gonna give Bella a blunt. No.
Okay. Well. In situations such as this, maybe. We should just sit. And wait. That's what I usually do. I just, you know. Go blank, and eventually somebody knocks on my head or something, and I come back to, and then things are usually all right. Sometimes I wake up with a, you know, cigarette burn or two, but usually things are generally okay.
Doing nothing, lost you arm and leg.
Oh, well,
Yeah, hopefully I'll get him back, but we'll see.
You take initiative. Don't let people decide for you.
Oh, well, you know, that's all I've done all my life is just let people decide what I do. And that's why I was a server. I wanted to be an entertainer, but they said I just didn't have what it took and I had to kind of work my way up. And so that's how I became a cigarette girl. And it was nice because I just did what they told me to do.
Mm. Think less, do more.
You both suddenly hear a sound, and the wall on one side actually begins to open up. And now it's open.
Is there what is the what?
The door, like, it's just, no one's coming in. The door just opened.
The door just opened, and now sunlight is like streaming in. The pale sunlight is still a little overcast, but daylight.
Oh. Cold-blooded, want sun.
Okay. Well, I don't know if we should leave Emma.
Am I wearing like a... What am I wearing?
I'm just imagining that you, like, maybe you've got like a cool like vest or something and like either like a loincloth or like pants, you know? Kind of just
like maybe
tattered kind of clothes, I'd imagine. Yeah, whatever it is.
I was like, could I like fashion something to like help strap Emma to my back or something? Like,
if you want, you could probably try to like, sure, you can attempt that. It would probably be a knowledge roll, so that's your
D8.
It's
not bad.
But as you're doing that,
yeah, I'll roll it.
Vella, what is your passive perception?
My passive perception is...
It's next to your hit dice on a green box. Third block of them down.
At 12.
12. Okay, yeah.
That's not bad.
After a few moments, you actually do sort of like hear that there is sort of something... like something is approaching that door.
I rolled an 8, by the way.
An 8. Okay, cool. You are able to like get her onto your back. Let's say it like that. You're able to like get, you know, kind of whether it's from fashioning some stuff or just kind of like tucking her legs into like the belt part of something. You know, yeah. You can get her.
I just want to carry her, but still use my arms.
As you're sort of doing that though, a sort of something comes standing at the door. Seems to be a woman, Vella. But like with the light behind her, you can't really get a good look at her. She's wearing like a, a coat with like a hood on it, like kind of like furry hood. She's just sort of standing there looking in at you guys.
I'm going to like instinctively kind of like, not like totally block Bella, but stand kind of like in front of her. Just like, all right. The crocodile, dude.
Actually, I will say that if you're trying to put, if you're trying to affix her to your back, you won't be able to do that at this time. You're still.
All right, I'll take that.
I'm gonna
take care of Emma. Bill, you handle that for a sec.
Initiative.
you can do.
Phil is just gonna say, hello.
Are you one of them? Did they just... Well, these are very strange if you are.
One of who?
I didn't realize he was working in here. Oh, that's a hideous thing he's made. Yes.
Oh.
Kind of looking at Stiltcutter. Oh, and look at you. You're missing limbs and made of wooden paint, aren't you?
Well, a little more than that. It's a complex polyfiber, actually.
What is he playing at? He wasted one on you. This is very strange indeed. What
wasted
you up?
What?
What could have dreamt you up? She kind of comes in, and you see that she's a woman in her maybe 40s or early 50s. She's wearing cold weather gear.
like mittens on her hand, although she's removing those now.
Well, nobody dreamt me up. I just, am.
There's a third.
Yeah, what's your name? I'm Vella.
You have a name. He gave you a name to start with.
Oh, well, he didn't, but hold on. Mannequins have mothers?
No, they have manufacturers.
We all come out the factory with names. And, you know, my name's Vella, but for the longest time, I thought my name was No Vella because people would say, No Vella. And it turns out they were just telling me not to do stuff. And that's just a story I like to tell when I'm introducing myself. What was your name?
You can call me Dr. Partridge.
Oh, a doctor. That's a... I don't think I've ever met a female doctor before. That's very impressive.
No, it's not.
Oh, is that common around here?
No, it's not.
I never... Oh! Well, that makes you even more special, doesn't it? Can I charm?
Sure.
Oh, wait. Wrong system.
Wrong system.
Never mind.
Make a persuade roll.
I just want to give the doctor, like... the mean mug predator eye. Like,
sure. Make it. That would be intuition, unfortunately. But yeah, give it
a 5.
I guess I can't sense the tension of the situation.
Yeah, exactly. It's. Although, okay. You know, if you wanted to, I'd let you do physicality. But since you're doing something kind of absurd, you'll have to roll 2 and use the lower one.
Okay.
You can roll 2d12 and use the lower. Vella.
5.
A 5. Yeah, you're just.
Not working.
She is just staring at you like.
5.
You're given the situation, you know that you didn't like make things worse, you didn't look silly or anything, but she does not seem afraid of you at all. This Dr. Partridge, she kind of pauses and what a strange batch.
Batch of what?
Batch of experiments.
Oh, we're not experiments. I mean, I'm from a tried and true manufacturing process, actually.
Is it backstories? Is that what he's trying?
Who? Who's he?
Stiltcutter. Parents. I have.
Oh, so you all... How'd you get in this room, then?
We just,
on beach.
Yeah, and then we were here.
What?
Do we recall being sucked through, or were we just seeing the horror?
I think you guys felt horror, but you do remember, like, being sucked into the sand. Yes, it was probably part of the terror.
Yeah, it was almost like we just got sucked in here after seeing something really terrifying and oddly specific to my personal...
How did you get up on the beach?
We on a ship.
Water.
Yeah, exactly.
Good God in heaven. And she backs up and slams something outside, and the door's locked.
Oh.
The wall just closes again.
Was it something I said?
Maybe.
All right. Now I'm making a very, very important call. Was it something I said? Maybe.
Now is a roll for Dr. Partridge. This could change a lot, although you guys will have a chance, but you know, this is a slow burning horror surge, so some bad things
could happen.
This is whether or not Dr. Partridge says, fuck this shit, burn that room.
Burn?
No.
I have, however, rolled a 9, which means that she will... Her terror will not get the best of her now. She's going to go have words with someone. And you guys are locked in here once again.
Oh my god.
Lamp Black. Make another survival roll to guide the sailor to where he wants to go.
Eight. I'm doing great.
All right. Lamp Black, we actually will we will not be jumping onto that then. As you lead him across. We sort of cut to you guys walking, but we're not going to sort of cut back to this because you're not going to make it here now. The sailor is being sort of very quiet. I think Lamp Black, you are noticing though that despite being on a peg, like, he can move very quick when he wants to. He's pretty spry, especially given how old he is. He often seems to carry himself in kind of like a loping, like, ah, I'm an old sailor, but it seems like when he wants to move, he's as quick as, you know, as any mobster, any hired gun. If there's anything you want to ask him as you try to make your way to here, but it's rough going, it's rough and slow going, you may do so.
He has actually just gotten a little more comfortable and changed back into Fletch.
Oh, understood. Cool.
So you just see him walking in a different form.
Understood. In that case, perhaps the sailor will sort of say,
"Ah, you're. Is it easier to move like that, lad?"
Sometimes you just want to change things up a little bit, and a little more friendly like this.
So you are.
Maybe.
So you seem.
Yeah. So what do you like to do for fun?
Sail, of course.
Do you sing songs?
And I have a suspicion, Fletch, that your hobby also involves sails.
Ah, that was a knee slapper, if I've ever heard one.
Yeah,
I was a salesman, Smedman Company. I sold widgets, bells and whistles, knickknacks, and fidgets.
So you did. What was your beat? Yeah, let's see. Was it paradise? No.
Mm-hmm.
Was it a heistlies?
Ah. What gave it away?
The fedora.
That does say noir, doesn't it?
I heard of them, not for a while, but I heard of them all right. I've been to the
factory
once or twice. So here's my question for you, lad. You right here, right now, if someone were to gut you, what spills out of you then? Is it blood or is it ink?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Yeah.
They carry on. So, Moses, would you roll me a D13? If it's over 13, roll it again. Or a D30. He knows he's rolling a D20. Everybody, he doesn't have a
D20. Yeah.
That's the point. Yeah.
Seven.
Seven.
What have I done?
Oh, great. So we are going to actually be moving away from this. You guys won't be getting resolution on this tonight. Sorry, everybody.
Oh, wait. If we move away from a horror surge, does it dissipate if time goes by?
No, the horror surge is done. You three are in a very bad situation.
Yeah.
But you're kind of... I think what the horror surge represented here was irrefutable capture.
Yeah.
And party splitting of a pretty significant variety. And there was a chance there, had somebody rolled bad, that they were just going to, like, you know, flash burn down the room which, you know, you guys still could have tried to fight your way out of, but it's a different kind of horror search tonight, but it's gonna get bad, don't worry. Tonight, the second horror search, or today's horror search was basically splitting the party, I'll phrase it like that. But with a 7, we're actually going to be moving over to a different storyline for just a brief bit here. We'll come back to the island soon, I'm sure, because we have a lot of questions about what's going on the island. But for now, I need to, Zane, I apologize because you won't. No, I take it back.
I don't need to be in everything. I'm
in everything.
I'm enjoying it as well.
If there's a cause for you, I need to have Sarah Quill and Solomon, please join us for a moment. We're back at Darkmoor.
So many characters, man.
So many characters.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Not compared to somebody.
That was me thinking about her accent.
So, Solomon. You, my dear friend. And this is this weird system where you just roll a lot of D8s. If you ever have one where there's a lot of D8s are necessary, please let us know and I can roll like a bunch on your behalf, just because, you know, sometimes it's kind of too much to like,
no,
roll 4 and remember what they all were. At this point, however, you are in a library at Hampstead Hall. Dracula told you to go in there. There was a very intriguing sort of vampire woman. And in fact, as you are sort of moving through the stacks, as there's this woman, Wednesday, she's kind of leading you through the stacks and sort of saying, "Do any of these books seem to catch your eye, sir?"
I just want to add that Solomon is probably gracefully moving through these stacks.
Absolutely. Solomon is, rephrase, Solomon is gliding through the stacks.
These books, full of such knowledge, such dedication, such passion. I want to eye a book with a beautiful spine, but looks like it's been read a lot of wear and tear.
Okay.
It's like that one.
Great. I love that. Make for me. I'm going to try to see if any of your things... No, nothing. You don't have anything that's specific for this. So, I think this will be
a... stuff for this too, right?
What's that?
Or add stuff? I still have to add stats to this one.
You actually can add some stats to this. So if you'd like to do that for this person, it's not a bad one. If you look under Will, the green column, there is a thing called Detect Vibe. You have 6 total dice you could add across different skills. If you wanted to, you could put up to 3 in Detect Vibe. That is what you're going to be rolling to choose the right book. That is, as you say, like...
I can add up to 3? I'll add 1.
You'll add 1, great. Okay, so your Detect Vibe is now 4 SD. So what you're going to do is roll, or have me or Lauren or whoever, roll 4 D8s. And we're looking to see, you want to say what the number of each one, like you don't want to add them up, you want to remember what each one is.
I feel like I have to pick the luckiest out of all of them. I'll take Lauren. She rolls pretty high.
Lauren, can you do 4d8? Do you have that handy? Sorry.
Yes.
I can roll, like, I got 1.
Tell you what, yeah, you roll 1, Lauren, you roll 3. That way you're involved. That's perfect.
Fair enough.
I don't want to give all the control away.
Makes sense.
There we go. Got a 6. Not bad.
Okay.
Oh, a 6, a 7, and a 2.
A 6, a 7, and a 2. So you do have a pair of 6s. So, and this one, to refresh everyone's memory, even though we do this on a lot of our other games. Yes, Moses, this is the game where it's not about height. It's about matches. But Lauren got you a match, so way to go. With a...
teamwork.
Old book with an interesting spine. I love it. Roll a D13 for me, as I say to you, the D20 where you subtract the other stuff.
Gotta roll again.
Yeah, sometimes you roll really high and you're like 18, 16, damn it. 13?
Yeah.
Roll it again.
Roll again.
Okay.
12.
12. Okay, great. So the good news for you is that, hey, all three of you have given me 113 tonight. That's really good. That's really good distribution. Thank you, everybody. So you do not cause another horror surge, which I really took it easy on everybody's new beloved characters and the other thing. I won't be doing that all the time, but this time I will. But if more horror surges happen, they will be as brutal as they should be. But with a 12, you avoid a horror surge. Having rolled a 13, great. Ooh. Okay. Ooh, but you said you wanted to be a weathered old tome.
Yes.
Okay. 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 That's a little hard for me to square the circle, but I can do it.
I believe it.
You pull down a book. This book is interesting. It doesn't seem to be a novel. And it has one of those, if anybody has ever been to, like, especially like university libraries where it's been bound in-house. This one it's an ornate in-house binding, but like the titling on it is not, this wasn't from like a publication. You think this is kind of akin to a lot of the other publications here where they just kind of have a sort of standard binding. But it's older. It's called Radioland Dreams.
Radioland Dreams.
A compendium of the greatest stars of radio. And then it has some dates listed that seem like an old, long time ago.
And am I holding the book at this point, or?
You have taken it off the shelves. Wednesday is kind of behind you going, that seems to be to your liking, sir. That book calls to you, sir.
It does. It's a book of stardom, fame, music.
Yes, sir. Sir, let me guide you this way, sir. And she kind of like moves you sort of just like across the library, and it's completely empty, but she takes you to like a couple of like very nice chairs. And just says, sit here, sir. I want you to start reading, sir.
Can I do a vibe check on her?
You can do it. It's actually, detect vibe is more for like an overall thing. You can do a read person on her.
Person.
If you wanted to add another die to that, you could, or you can just roll.
Yeah.
Do you want to just roll three, or should I roll?
I'm just gonna roll the three.
Roll the three. Cool.
7. 4. 5. Nah.
You don't have a good vibe on her. She just seems creepy. And Solomon, she does seem to be staring at your neck a lot, but there's been a lot of that going around. You just have a really nice neck.
Solomon has a well-chiseled neck.
But at this point, the door opens, and three more people walk into the room. One of them is saying, my darling, you have, I would not say you have embarrassed yourself, but you have not put your best foot forward. And poor Mr. Brannigan is now deceased. That is an ally we no longer have. That is a benefit, a connection we no longer have. You must become more in control of your urges.
Yeah, I'm trying, but it is difficult sometimes.
But you have embarrassed yourself in front of Dracula, my love.
I understand that. And I do also understand, and she'll like go and like trace her hand down his chest and say, and I do understand that I may have to be punished later, and I do hope that you can forgive me one day.
Oh, darling, I don't know that you understand. Or actually, wait, maybe this is what she... Are you saying that Dracula's going to punish you?
No, he is, but...
Oh, okay, understood. Gotcha.
She just doesn't want him to be mad at her.
Etienne will say, my darling, I will not be the one punishing you. That will be up to your new king. And that means that your bad behavior is an embarrassment to me. This is unacceptable.
I'm sorry. I couldn't help it. You know, this is all very new to me still. I'm trying to adapt to this lifestyle, and it's been very fun and indulgent, and I'm sorry.
Well, tell this to our dearly departed Francis Brannigan. Oh, look, there is, and Ingrid says, yes, I see him, my little dancing boy. He is in a chair reading a book. Perhaps I can go just take little sips out of his toes while he reads. No one will be bothered by this, yeah? Think I can sink my fangs into him? Taste the mammalian blood? Let it mingle with the chlorophylls in my mouth, yeah? Is this... And Etienne is like... This friend of yours, Sarah, she is very strange to me.
Can Solomon feel a tingle of his spine?
I think, Solomon, you definitely feel a tingle. She's like, how about just little tiny pecks and nibbles of his toesies? At this point, however, Wednesday sort of glides up and says, no, miss. You can't be taking any bites of anyone, miss. Not until the Count says it's all right, miss. Oh, this is such a party pooper. Well, can I go and sit with him at least? That should be fine, miss. Just control yourself. She then looks at Sarah and says, although I hear that is something some of us are having great trouble with, miss. You still have blood on your lips, miss. She kind of comes forward and just like starts like wiping blood off your lips.
Yes, well, it's something that I'm working on. We all have our shortcomings.
Your eyebrows are wheat, miss. You have flowers in your hair. It's very strange, miss.
Thank you.
You're a different...
I think they're rather nice.
You're a different kind of vampire, aren't you, miss?
Well, I believe so. I wasn't familiar with the lore of the kind of vampire that I currently am, but I am aware that there are other ones. Because, you see, in another life, so to speak, I did study the occult and certain strange mysteries. But yes, I suppose I am a different type of vampire.
Well, perhaps that can be an excuse where you're from, miss. But here, my husband, the Count, he demands better behavior, miss.
I will try. And she'll like do a little bow to her.
Oh, I like that, miss.
Oh, I can bow lower if you'd like.
Yes.
And she will do so.
Solomon.
Sarah!
I need Solomon to roll a... Solomon, just roll a basic will. So just roll 3d8.
Okay.
As you're just trying to like.
One.
Okay.
One.
Okay.
Five.
So, Solomon, maybe it's your dance training coming in, but you've rolled grammar is what you've rolled here. You've rolled structure, order, constraint. There is something going on between two of these ladies over here that is, like, weird. Then this German vampire who was talking to you, she's come and she's, like, sitting, like, in the chair next to you, just staring at you. And you notice she's looking at your feet a lot.
Like, see something you like.
Do you say that?
Yeah.
Yes, I very much do. I have a very... intrigued feeling in my body right now, all the way from my stocks to my stamen.
I mean, it just seems like you recognize what hard work looks like. These feet have danced countless hours. They're strong. But yet soft. This delicate.
This is so interesting. You know, I have always admired feet. I always equate them to the roots and the stalks of a plant. They dig down and extend, right? They anchor you. Yeah.
Yes. They're what anchor me to the floor to give me power when I move and I dance. You get. I like that. I like that. I like you.
Yeah, I like you too. I can't do anything with you yet, but I hope one day soon to be able to.
Oh my.
You are such so a unique specimen.
You guys are such a forward and interesting group.
Oh, believe me, once you die and you become the undead, you realize there's no need to wait. You should take what you want.
How life, weirded out am I by her saying that?
Life is wasted on the living. You can be as weirded out by these comments as you'd like.
I'm trying to remember, do I know that they're vampires?
Well, that's an interesting question, Solomon. I'm going to say based on sort of things you've said already and the general vibe around campus. And I mean, this is a school with an occult studies program. So yeah, yes, I think that you understand there's a lot of vampires here. And as far as you know, they're not going to eat you. So you're kind of like very happy to flirt with this weird German lady.
I've never thought about becoming a vampire, but dancing forever doesn't sound so bad. But I think mortality just makes your passion that much stronger, right?
Oh, yes. No. I would not want to turn you. You would be, you'll be a much better feast than companion for all of time, yeah. Keep reading your book. That's what they told you to do, isn't it?
Yes, I don't know why.
I will just watch you turning the pages of my dead processed cousins, yeah? That's what paper is, after all.
I'm gonna give a nervous laugh back.
Sarah, still, you're still with Wednesday, and you've kind of bowed lower. Hmm. I'll just roll this to see how weird stuff's about to get.
Wednesday will say, "No, miss, on your knees, miss."
Will it give me forgiveness?
I don't know, miss. But you certainly won't have any without it.
Okay. She'll get on her knees. Where is Etienne?
Standing right behind her.
Oh, God.
He pulls out a cigarette and starts smoking.
This is some Wattpad stuff. She's gonna get on her knees on the floor and slide forward toward Wednesday's feet with her ass in the air. And then look up at Wednesday.
Wednesday sort of stares down at you. So basically Etienne is just like, this is the cover of the book too. Etienne's just like smoking behind her. Meanwhile, there's a college student reading next to a plant vampire watching him as another plant vampire's on the floor crazy. Etienne's behind smoking, watching his wife do this. And the maid, who's now married to Dracula ahead of it, kind of just looks down and says, she leans down really close, Sarah, and says, "Oh, miss, there might be hope for you yet." And then she grabs your hair and like pulls back and pulls out some of your flowers.
Ow! Wait, does it hurt?
Yeah.
Sarah will scream in both pain and pleasure?
That's up to you.
Sure.
This is a game. What is this side of the story? I think everybody's about to get laid.
You know, Etienne is they have a marriage that they go on, Phil.
Etienne just sort of smokes and I don't know. He just takes this all in. The eyes of an angel are hard to read. They can be very hard to read. But it seems like perhaps Sarah has found a means of maybe making things up to, if not Dracula, then to his inner circle. So we'll leave Sarah and Solomon there. As Solomon begins to read Radio Dreams. Actually, Solomon, I will let you make, this is not one of your skills, although if you want to, you could throw some dice atop this. We'll leave with one last thing, which is typically it has been analyzed. That's what you guys would usually roll to read, right? Mm-hmm. Would I let you, Lauren, would I let you guys, or Zane as well, when you were doing, like, in Darkmoor, would I let you do Detect Vibe when you were reading the books, or was it always Analyze?
Analyze.
Was it always Analyze?
Analyze, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so if you'd like to, you could add some dice to Analyze. You could add 4 of your remaining 5 to max it out at 6 dice, or you could add a couple. Analyze will be an important thing. So basically, if you think that Solomon, in addition to his fantastic dancing, is a good student, and is like a good reader, that's what is going to be incredibly important for what he's been chosen for here. So I would do at least 1 die for this for sure. But
I'll hit 2.
2. Get it to 4. I think that's a great idea. All right. So
Solomon's a good student.
So in that case, I need 1 analyze roll. You have 3 total dice left to add where you want. So you're gonna roll 4d8, and let's see if we get any matches. And if you don't now, it's okay. You'll have a lot of opportunities in the future.
2 7s.
7s. Ooh. 7s is astronomy. 7s is stars and patterns and repetition. And that's a very good thing to do in these.
What does Solomon see?
As you begin to read this book, kind of trying to tune out the psychosexual drama going on over there between Wednesday and Sarah.
Solomon's hearing it, though.
I think Solomon, I will say Solomon, you know what, Solomon, also give me a detect vibe. This is a detect vibe situation. So roll your
Solomon fork. He's here and he's like, what am I doing up here?
Yeah.
I have to roll 4 of these?
Yeah. 4 of those, yeah.
6, 7, 5, 7. 2 7s.
2 more 7s. I think that you get the impression that I think it's actually exactly what you said. Like you're not, like, you don't know if it's going to be in this room, but like, it's like, and maybe based on what this woman here has been doing and like this stuff, you're like, you're just like, vampires, fuck. Vampires, like, get into it. And it's weird. And like, this lady's husband is just like smoking and watching. Like, it's like, this is going to be some stuff is going to be happening here. So the point being, but on Radioland Dreams,
yes,
you, as you sort of go through this book, you begin to realize that what this is an accounting of various, it is so funny a fate that you rolled a 13 there when you did. That actually is because that means surfing domain, and you said old, which means we go to this. This is an accounting of radio stars in like the days before television. This is an accounting of famous radio dramas. An accounting of radio dramas or like comedy shows. All these old broadcasters, colorful characters. It has a lot of photographs of people like in booths, you know, like performing these radio plays live.
Mm-hmm.
Certain characters who appear in. So you begin to connect with this stuff, but as of yet you're just kind of going through it. It's not a full. There are some scripts involved, so you can read sections of it. But yeah, you're kind of, it's interesting. And one thing that's notable about it is it seems to like, it's fixated on like one radio station, but it's also fixated on like surfing the dial, like going between different ones. So. As you go through that, we are actually going to cut back now, one last time, to Fletch and the sailor. So Fletch, I'm going to give you another opportunity to
know where we're going.
Give me another survival. Let's see if things have improved.
Come on, baby. I think they have. That is a dirty 20.
A dirty 20. You, having kind of like, you were taking a cautious path and you got a little bit sidetracked, but you eventually figure out where you're going and you've sort of like guided the sailor kind of almost the long way around. You haven't gone all the way around the mountain, but you kind of like a long way around. And you now have gotten to, you're not there yet, but like you're at a place where like you've been going through forest and kind of like up like a little like kind of up like a part on the side of the mountain. But now the trees part and you can see down below that weird little sort of complex that you found yourself in. There are the specific thing that you snuck your way out of. There are 13 chambers in a circle. They're about 20 foot square, each one, and they're kind of like arranged. They are numbered from the top, from above you can see them. They are numbered in Roman numerals 1 through 13. And that is where you were taken the last time.
Did he remember where he was taken specifically? Which one he was held in?
Roll the D13.
Well, that's a 13, baby.
Roll.
Zane.
Roll another.
We did.
So many times. No.
Oh my god. Horror surge right now. It will be so rough.
7.
Okay. We're at 9. Guys, we started at 5 and now we're at 9. You were in number 13.
Well, there it is. That's where I was held. I was in lucky number 13.
Were ya? It's an auspicious number.
Yeah, I've heard that.
You simply snuck your way out of there, is that right?
And he takes his hand and just shows how he might sneak out by turning it in.
You'll go full lamp black for a moment to kind of sort of, you know, slorch. But he says,
I see. It's a neat trick, as I said. Well, they're in one of them, you think?
I'm certain.
I think you've brought me more to some of the other things I'm looking at as well. Tell me
what
that.
Might that be?
Sorry, what'd you say?
And what might that be?
Well, I'm intrigued by what those are, but I'm more intrigued by that.
And he points to a sort of larger structure. It is not medieval in build, but there is something that is clearly fortress-like about it. It is definitely like a fortified thing. It is built kind of like just at the foot of the mountain. These are sort of also at the foot of the mountain, but this is almost like built onto the mountain, kind of there at the base. Fletch, I don't think you ever would have gone into this structure, but you probably have checked it out on a few occasions. You've probably looked at it. There seems to be a lot of very scary stuff that comes in and out of it.
That's, I don't know if that's something you want to be exploring much. There's a lot of scary stuff coming in and out of it.
The sailor says,
aye, but like we said earlier, it's why we're here, ain't it? That's where the good stuff is, I wager.
Well, to each their own, but, I mean, aren't we here to just help your friends?
No, we're here to help my friends so they can help us. So we can gain power, right? We can learn secrets,
He looks up at the mountain, just billowing out that mist.
So we can find the source.
Source.
The source of that which used to separate and now unites in terror. That's where it all comes from, lad. Every single particle in molecular mist was pumped out of that. And there's always more, ain't there? That's the nice thing about dread, lad. There's always more. I like to go swimming with bow-legged women and swim between their legs. What was that?
So I take it you're a proponent of the mist.
Aye. Not a proponent or an enemy, but I'm unaffected by him. And I don't mean it like in that I get a free pass. I don't mean they make a little passage for me like they do for you lads from the factory. No, I mean I can breathe it in and out like it were air.
What do you want to do with it?
That remains to be seen, lad. You see, they broke the mist, didn't they? Those bastards. They tore it all apart. The side that I work for lost. So where does that leave an old salt like myself?
You're a conservative? Do you want the mist back?
A conservative? I don't quite understand. That seems like a false equivalency between those who... I don't know that's quite applicable well. Suffice it to say that me and my friends in the Alliance, the bounty hunter and the journalist and the drifter, well, now the bounty hunter's got vengeance on her mind. And she'll get it, believe you me. The journalist, when last I spoke to him, he'd gone a bit. Gone a bit batty. He's working on a new story. He thinks he's got a new angle. And the drifter, well, no one ever really liked the drifter. Which means I'm a man with friends, but a man all on me own. And when a sailor's able to chart his own course, that's when something truly special can happen, ain't it?
If you say so.
Oh, I do say so. Come, lad. Let's find me passengers and get ourselves a little bit of power. Aye. Just a wee bit of power to us both good, I think.
You remember what I said?
Oh yeah, believe me, I'll follow what you say when we're down there. I certainly don't want to be getting killed by any nonsense, I'll tell you that. And I'll stop singing me songs once we're close enough for hearing range. But until then, what will we do with a drunken sailor? What will we do with a drunken sailor? What will we do with a drunken sailor? Early eye in the morning. Pull out the plug till he's wet all over. Pull out the plug till he's wet all over. Pull out the plug till he's wet all over. Early eye in the morning. Yar, yar, yar. Here we go down the... Ah, downhill.
Fletch just really enjoyed making music with somebody because it's been a while.
Aww.
Is that the song he does?
He was just whistling along with it.
Oh, okay. He doesn't want to do It's Been a While? It's been a while since I can't open the secretary to bring different. I don't know the words to that, just the It's Been a While part. That's where we're going to end tonight's session. So, just to recap, we had a horror surge that brought some people into maybe certain death. I'll phrase it like this. They are in a position where there is certain death at the push of a button.
Yeah.
That is dangerous. There's a sword of Damocles hanging over them.
Everybody's favorite characters.
Yeah. It's rough. That's the horror surge's tension. We also got to see if you're here for the Wattpad fanfic, we did get a scene of that, of Sarah like sliding across the floor to if any longtime viewers of the channel, if you'd said 6 months ago, you're going to be able to see
Vampire Sarah Quill.
Plant Vampire Sarah
Wednesday
Quill.
Wednesday Smut.
Vampire Wednesday Smut with Etienne watching and smoking. Yeah. So if you're into smoking.
I feel like any of the Sarah Quill, Etienne stuff has just shown me constantly, I just don't play this game horny enough.
The thing is, I'm gonna throw this out there. Never force the horniness. Like, if you force the horn, it has to come in the moment. That's what she said. Everyone, thank you all for watching. This was a delight. I hope that we enjoyed whatever the hell just happened here.
It feels like it was a 4-hour game.
Because so much happened and so much, and there were, I think also you were understanding there were some kind of like, should I mention anything about like the Smedman Company and what that references and what that's about?
Yeah.
I will simply say that it still is on our downloads page on the thing. There is a novella.
I was saying this in the chat.
Oh yeah, there is a novella set in the Blood from a Stone universe about a traveling salesman in paradise.
Let me find it.
Interesting. That's just a thing. So perhaps Fletch has some similarities with old Horace. With old Horace from that book. Horace, who was very connected to Carla, who showed up later when she and the Soldier of Fortune had a fight. Please go to our Discord to interact with us. I think I can pull that up by doing that. Yeah, go to our Discord to interact with us, go to our YouTube to see old episodes, go to our Instagram to know when we actually are going live. Go to our wiki to see stuff about players, systems, games. Some episodes even have like recaps and stuff, so that's pretty cool. We have games on Sunday. We are back with Here Be Dragons at 7:30 p.m. Pacific. On Tuesday, we have more Strange Lore at 4 p.m. Pacific. Then on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Pacific, we have a Lost Lore Academia, like, catch-up, like, cramp study session, maybe I should call it, or something like that. It won't really be a game, it'll just be we can, like, have the players back, and we'll chat about what happens. We've been off for the summer for third time's the charm. Third time's the charm had some big revelations in its closing episode, right? That was weird, huh? I don't know. It's almost like maybe Philip is a sick person with too many ideas. So join us for all that. And then 1 week from tonight, we're back with chapter. It is not a multiple, so I want to stress that though it's an exciting one, it's not a multiple. But next week is chapter 113 of Blood from a Stone. So even though it's not a multiple of 13, it still has 13 in it, and that's a pretty big deal. So yeah, please come join us for that. A lot of fun here. Do we have people to say thank you to or shout outs and any of that stuff?
Oh, look at me not being on top of it. We had PVD followed us 50 minutes ago. We had, so thank you, PVD. Thank you for following. We had Emmy Bear Grr follow 2 hours ago, like before the show even started.
That's impressive.
And it was our first chat as well. So thank you for the two new follows this evening.
Wonderful. Should we plug specific things or just say go to everybody's about page? Sometimes I start saying plug everyone's socials and everyone's like, I don't want to plug the social today. And then it seems like a mistake was made.
Go to the about page.
We have our players get up to wonderful stuff. They stream at intermittent times and do things. And actually, if you go to our Discord, I think most people in our Discord will post when they're going live on various things on the Discord. So it's in the promotions tab there. So you can check that out too. Thank you all so much. This was a delight. Thank you, players. I'm so glad you were here. I hope that you enjoyed this totally chill and not at all frightening episode, Blood from a Stone, where no characters died, so that's good.
I know.
Hey, what if I'd rolled a 2 on her fear, and she just roasted you guys, and that was the end of, and Emma would have died when she wasn't even here. Oh no, that would have been bad.
Fan favorite character just going down.
It can happen.
Like that too.
It can happen. That's great. All right, thank you all so much for watching. Until next time, have a dreadful night. Bats, mist and bats, scary ghosts and lots of bats. Ooh, is that bats? Or bats would be like...
It looks like it.
Yeah.
Or...
Still, are we still on? Is this still happening?
Yep, I'm still on.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, y'all.